It is an honor to address this conference on issues relating to strategies that Goddard Enterprises has used successfully to maintain steady growth irrespective of the stage of the economic cycle. As we are all aware, the current economic crisis of 2008 to 2011 and ongoing is the worst shock that the global economies have suffered since the 1930s. How has GEL been able to weather this storm so far? GEL is a multinational conglomerate with 60 operating entities located throughout the Caribbean and Latin America, from Miami in the north to Uruguay in the south. And it is structured with four main divisions, namely import distribution and marketing, manufacturing, in-flight catering, and lastly, financial and other services. Only approximately 25% of our sales originate in Barbados. Whilst this diversity has its management challenges, it has undoubtedly cushioned the group from the effects of the economic downturn. In 2008, before the crisis really took hold and affected our results, GEL had its best year ever, with group turnover reaching Barbados $955 million. The rate of exchange is one US to two Barbados dollars. A profit from operations totaling Barbados $61.7 million, and earnings per share reaching just over 74 cents per share. Over the following 2 years, our turnover dropped by 8% to Barbados $878 million, with operating profit at Barbados $43.1 million and earnings per share at 46.1 cents from the 2010 financial year. Indications are that we should end our financial year, which is at the end of September 2011, with sales of around $922 million Barbados dollars, with an operating profit of just over $51 million and earnings per share back up to 50 cents per share, still not anywhere near our record year of 2008. Hopefully, the crisis is now at an end and we should experience continued growth for 2012 and beyond, albeit at a reduced rate. We are seeing our sales in the group slowly increasing again over this financial year, and I'm pretty confident that hopefully in 2012 we will see a bit more growth. I'm not saying we're out of the abscess yet, but at least we are seeing this growth. How did we at GEL go about managing in tough economic times? When the going gets tough, the tough gets going, as the saying goes. We made sure that gloom and doom were not allowed to rule the roost. Out of disaster comes great opportunities for the better managed companies. Here is a synopsis of our strategies which we followed to enable us to weather the storm and become a stronger group of companies. One, we took a closer look at our businesses. The goalposts were moving and we had to understand the true picture and not what we would like to believe. We had to get to the bottom of what was driving our businesses, what we did best and why. We had to analyze and understand how the businesses were being impacted by the downturn. Two, we acted decisively. With increased uncertainty and volatility, it was important to take tough decisions early. In easy times, it is human nature to duck hard decisions. We were not risk-averse and took calculated risks after reviewing all available information and the current external environment. We became more hands-on. We focused relentlessly on key drivers and key risks across the businesses. We didn't sit back and wait. We knew that survivors would be those that positioned themselves to take advantage of the upturn. We became more aggressive and ruthless towards competitors. And I'll give you an example. Where we ran a company with several business units, we decided to discount unit selling prices in one department, the cost of which was absorbed across other departments in order to put pressure on the business of a sole competitor. That sole competitor, unfortunately, didn't have the departmental spread that we were allowed, you know, gave us some flexibility. We became more competitive with our exports of manufactured goods by calculating key product markups on marginal cost of production and not full costs, because we knew that sales in the home market were covering all fixed costs. Three, we remembered that cash is king. Positive cash flow to a business is like fuel to a car. We ensured that our finances and working capital were in good order, protected our liquidity by improving accounts receivable and inventory turnover ratios. We were firm but fair with customers. We ensured that reasonable credit limits were put in place and credit payment terms were rigorously enforced. We became serious about inventory management. We improved warehouse management to reduce stock obsolescence, wastage, damage, and pilferage. We improved stock ordering procedures. All large orders had to be approved by the general manager, head buyer, and financial controller. We put in place an open-to-buy system whereby dollar purchasing limits were put in place based on required margins, stock turns, and projected future customer demand. This did not mean that we restricted a competent buyer on what items he or she should buy, but only as to how much cash was available to spend. It also put pressure on the buyer to turn old stock into cash to enable more purchases to be made. It was not the time to be holding large stock levels during a period of declining purchase prices and demand. We re-examined our treasury financing and funding exposures. We ensured that debt to equity ratios were well within acceptable limits. As everyone knows, in a downturn, a company with more debt is more susceptible to volatility in profitability and lower earnings per share than a company with less debt. Conversely, in good times, a more highly geared company within acceptable limits will generate higher earnings per share than a lower leveraged company. We monitored our performance against financial and non-financial benchmarks. We adopted a hands-on approach to cash management. My current chairman once told me that one of the easiest ways to control cash was to take away the checkbook. That doesn't really stop ordering, but it does have an effect on when the cash is flying out of the business. Four, we focused on what really mattered. We evaluated which companies, products, customers, and departments created or destroyed value. We remembered the 80-20 rule. Generally, 20% of our stock items or customers generated 80% of our sales and, by inference, profitability. We made customer service and satisfaction a priority. We did what took to keep our customers loyal. We revisited our existing capital investment programs. We asked ourselves the question, what initiatives could we stop or defer? We managed our cost base. We focused on enhancing operational performance, went for targeted rather than across-the-board cuts. We asked ourselves the question, would I spend my own personal funds in the manner in which I intend to spend the company's funds? We extracted better value via lower wastage and higher yields. We cut out the fat with which the businesses had inevitably put on during the good times. We reduced unnecessary complexity. We looked at whether our business model needed to change. Six, were our management information systems reliable? Now more than ever, we needed the right management information, which was accurate, produced on time. Clearly defined KPIs, key performance indicators, were essential. Decision-making needed to be based on facts and not gut feel. Speed of decision-making needed to improve. Seven, we planned for different scenarios. Winners demonstrate agility and flexibility. We modeled a range of financial, operational, and workforce scenarios that reflected the impact of the downturn on our businesses. We tried to adapt quickly. We explored our strategic options. Eight, and very important, we recognize the value of our people. Regular and clear communication with employees is key to their buy-in. We identified key talent and developed appropriate incentives for them. Retaining and motivating our best people were critical to our future. We tried to keep morale high. If necessary, we retained people by rotation, working a shorter week instead of laying them off. Nine, we took our stakeholders with us. We evaluated the likely impact of the downturn on our stakeholders, customers, suppliers, labor unions, our bankers, governments, employees, and shareholders. We made sure that we understood their agendas and they understood ours. Perception is often reality, so maintaining regular and open dialogue was essential. If a good customer needed extended payment terms and had a history of prompt payment, we looked positively on his request for extended payment terms to assist him in this crisis. Those customers will remember us, hopefully, for our help when the upturn starts to occur or has started to occur. A reliable customer lost is hard to win back. 10, we took advantage of the opportunities. We didn't stop innovating or investing in those areas of growth we needed for the future. We didn't forget our brands. We spent wisely on brand advertising. Our competitors may actually have been reducing their advertising spend. In a downturn, we thought it better to increase advertising, not to cut it. We kept an eye for the future, thinking beyond the next month by re-engineering and retaining our businesses and becoming lean and mean, enabled us to survive and to continue to survive this crisis and grow. We put the heat up on our competitors, especially those with stage fright. There were opportunities for us to gain market share or acquire those competitors who were not so efficient and became victims of the downturn. We have now weathered the storm successfully, and we know we are in a much better position to take advantage of the upturn. The challenge will be to continue with the above strategies, even in good times. I hope the above comments are useful and make sense. This is a war out there in the business world, and only the fit and smart will survive. I believe that GEL is one of those few companies that made it through the downturn relatively unscathed, and is a better run company as a result. It is my opinion that whilst we are not fully out of this economic downturn yet, the worst is over, and hopefully 2012 will offer a better climate to do business. I would just like to make a comment about CSME, and I get the impression that governments have seemed to have put this on the back burner since it was first mooted several years ago, and I think we need to get back on track with CSME because it will definitely help the region, in my opinion, to grow economically. I will now finally round off my presentation by quoting Harry S. Truman, who lived from 1884 to 1972 and was the 33rd President of the United States. And I quote, "A pessimist is one who makes difficulties of his opportunities, and an optimist is one who makes opportunities of his difficulties." It is a given that all of us at GL are optimists. Thank you very much.